Greetings. Today we're going to have some fun. We're going to review the injection pressure monitors that are available on the market. The first thing that we're going to do, however, we're going to talk very briefly about injection pressure monitoring. That has become a standard over the last decade or so during peripheral nerve blocks to monitor for intrafascicular needle placement. Now, injection pressure monitoring is nothing new. Doc Seelander, back in 1978, has published that insertion of the needle into the fascicle can result in a very high injection pressure and a far spread of the local anesthetic towards the CSF. And indeed, in his paper, he clearly documented that as little as 0.1 milliliter of local anesthetic injected into the fascicle leads to the rupture of the fascicle. At that point in time, the damage is already done. So the theory you can use ultrasound to detect an intrafascicular injection goes out of the water, because as little as 0.1 is necessary milliliter to rupture the fascicle. And then again, it's already too late. So detecting the pressure before the rupture occurs is what we're trying to do with injection pressure monitoring. Namely, we monitor the opening injection pressure. And here you can see the injection pressure during injection around the fascicle or outside of the nerve is very low. And here you can see opening injection pressure is very high once you inject into the fascicle. Some 30 years later, we have published or reproduced the findings that Doc Seelander did in rabbits, but this time in dogs. And what we found is that intraneural injection with high injection pressure leads to fascicular injury and neurologic deficit in dogs. So let's review that. If you look at the injection pressures or opening injection pressures during an injection outside of the nerve in a perineural space, you can see the injection pressures are very, very low consistently. However, if you inject into the nerve, there are two possible scenarios. The first scenario is a low injection pressure, and this is what happens when the needle is inserted into the nerve but outside of the fascicle, between the fascicles. And here you can have very high injection pressures, and that occurs only when the needle is inserted into the fascicle inside the nerve. So this is what we really worry about. And here's those examples. This is an example of an intraneural but extrafascicular needle placement, where you basically just get a very wide distribution of the local anesthetic underneath the epineurium inside the nerve, but no nerve injury. However, when the injection occurs inside the fascicle, that is when you get an intraneural, intrafascicular injection with an injury to the fascicle that may or may not heal. This definitely has consequences. And this is exactly what we're trying to prevent by monitoring opening injection pressure, so that even if the needle enters the fascicle or butts the fascicle, you basically have a chance to see or stop injection before the injury occurs. But fortunately, needles are much more likely to pass through the nerve rather than to injure fascicles. And that is the inherent safety of peripheral nerves. Otherwise, we would have injuries every day. So again, needle tends to pass between the fascicles rather than through the fascicle. But if the needle gets lodged into one of these small fascicles and injected into, clearly that will lead to an unforgivable injury. Injection into the nerves also under high pressures also can have other consequences, such as inflammatory changes. And this is Velkel and colleagues. They have really very clearly documented that if you inject it into the nerves, you can still have inflammatory changes, which in patients can be manifested by a few days of paresthesias, dysesthesias, and things like that, not necessarily always an overt nerve injury. And with that introduction, let's look into the commercially available injection pressure monitors and see how they function. As you can see, there are several different devices that are available. First off, there's a BSmart, and a BSmart is a device that basically has a piston incorporated. So as the pressure builds, the piston goes up, and then you can follow the certain color range. The color range, white is less than 15 psi. The yellow indicates the pressure is building to 15 to 20 psi. And the red color indicates that the pressure is over 20 psi, at which point in time the clinician may decide to stop with an injection, prevent the injection, or to go on if the needle or ultrasound is deemed to be placed appropriately. Now, another device is a nerve guard. The nerve guard functions more as a limiter. In other words, once the nerve guard reaches either 15 or 20 PSI, the injection is immediately stopped. And finally, there is Safira device, which is made by Medivate. And Medivate basically built this device in order to allow automated injection of local anesthetic during no-block performance, where the clinician steps on a foot pedal or controls by hand, and the device senses the pressure and stops when the pressure builds up over 20 PSI and allows you to inject the nerve block injection all by yourself. Now, there are several differences among these devices. All of them will do the job. However, this device over here, the BSmart, allows you to detect the high opening injection pressure, and as well also allows you to make a decision whether you want to proceed with an injection or not. These other devices, such as nerve guard or Safira, they work as limiters. In other words, once they reach a certain injection pressure, they simply stop. The difference is between the two is a matter of choice. This has benefits because you can make decisions as a clinician. These two devices have benefits because you can never make a mistake. The device simply stops the injection no matter what. And here's how the process of injecting local anesthetic during nerve blocks while monitoring injection pressure goes. So you want to place a needle first and assure the absence of injection pressure greater than 20 PSI. Then if this pressure is less than 20 PSI, you start with an injection, making sure that it continues under 20 PSI. And then once you start an injection, if you need to, you can increase the injection speed or whatever to optimize the spread. And then any time when you reposition the needle to another place, again, you go to step number one, where you want to make sure that your injection pressure or opening injection pressure is below the 20 PSI. In addition to these commercially available injection pressure monitors, also there's a compression injection technique to standardize block injection pressures. This was published by Ben Tsui, and it's a method that actually you can use air compression within the syringe in order to determine when there is too much of an opening pressure. And that was it. Injection pressure monitoring has become a standard of care in many institutions. And nowadays, in addition to all of these different commercially available injection pressure monitors, you also can use air in the syringe so that you always know when you exert too much pressure on the plunger. Until next time, and if you do like our videos, make sure you subscribe.